All right. Well, I got some prayer requests here, so if you guys would join me, we'll take it to the Lord, and then we'll get into some praise together, all right? Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you, Lord, for not only caring and inviting us to cast our cares upon you, but Lord, being so patient with us when we question the way that you move and answer and respond. Lord, your word says that what we're doing tonight does avail much. Lord, we believe that. We've seen that. More importantly, your word declares it. And yet, Lord, at the same time, we know that you're infinite in wisdom. We're not. You give us a smidgen of wisdom, and we thank you for it, but Lord, you're all-knowing, obviously, and so we rest in that. Lord, we bring matters before you the best way we know how, and just like a little child would come to a parent and call out to them as their papa. Lord, we do that now, and just ultimately rest in the love that you have, the wisdom that you have, the concern that you have, the power that you have, Lord, the power to move in the seen realm and the unseen realm. So, Lord, with that in mind, bring in Janet before you. Father, as you know, she's suffering with COVID pneumonia, is currently intubated in the hospital, not doing well. Her husband passed a week ago, and Lord, I suspect there in some ways is just a desire to be with him and you. So Lord, our prayer is just to commit her to you, just to bring her before you. And Lord, and ask you to touch that life of that sister Janet. And Father, with our brother Ed, our faithful brother, to remember our first responders and active duty service and families and vets and their families. And so again this week, saying, Lord, thank you for them, asking you, Lord, to bless them, especially within our own community, but certainly not limited to that. Lord, praying for the sacrifice that they make and their families too, kind of the unsung heroes often. In the ranks of the first responders are those that support them, encourage them, are there for them when they're off duty. Lord, we pray that those that find themselves struggling with just the stress from traumatic situations, things they've seen, Lord, whether it was the fatality, the accident on Beach Boulevard last night, to war zones, and all things in between, Lord. It's traumatic to the brain to see. And so, Father, we pray for them to look to you for help and comfort in such times that they find themselves just overwhelmed by that. Lord, with Ed, also asking you to, as the song goes, to shed your grace on our nation. And Lord, that's what it is. It's unmerited favor. And we need it, and we ask for it. And Lord, we ask too for more men and women of honesty and integrity in our leadership, locally, in our county, state, and our nation. Lord, for men and women that would honor you in the position, and not try to serve self, but serve others. And Lord, so help us in that regard. Lifting up also Brother Pete after a bicycle accident, cracking some ribs. And Lord, we pray for his speedy recovery. He's a busy guy, an active guy, and I'm sure wants to get back to serving you. But praying for his quick recovery. With our Brother Gilbert, lifting up his mom, Martha, in her car accident yesterday. Lord, thanks that she's home now, but still feeling a little beat up. So God, we pray for this comfort and healing from Martha. And also for Gilbert's niece, Kara, Lord, in her leg and whatever's the source of that injury, Lord, for healing for her and get her back to the activities that she loves to be about, and like softball. Then with her brother Daniel, Father, again, this week, and I trust until to the day that we don't need to pray for it anymore, Lord, for the ongoing epidemic of abortion in our land. Lord, it's just such a plight on a people, and God, help us. Lord, be merciful to us. Lord, open eyes to see the reality of a little baby. Lord, raise up more groups like Horizon Pregnancy Clinic. Provide, Father, for the many, many groups like that to be able to have that machinery to perform an ultrasound so that mother and that father, if he's there, can see the life, can see that little one, and see that it's not a mass of tissue, but it's a life. And so, Lord, we thank you that there are many serving in that area, and Lord, thank you for your grace and goodness despite that. Lord, to the brother Vince, lifting up our border situation and those men and women that serve in that capacity, especially on the Texas border. Lord, it's been overwhelming for a lot of them and frustrating. And Lord, frustration in the workplace is a difficult thing, especially the many hours and the extra hours that they're putting in down there. And so, Lord, we pray you'd help them. We pray, Lord, that you'd help them to not grow weary in well-doing. Lord, we pray for some order and things to be done in an orderly fashion in the way it was set up to be done, Lord. Lord, we need so much repair nationally, and I guess, Lord, it's the same with us individually. Lots of work to be done. Lord, thanks for the work you have been doing. Lord, we are all in this room. Really, it's just a testimony of the transforming work that you do, Lord. It's something that you're doing, you're committed to doing. We get to cooperate with you, work with you, but Lord, the real work, the transformation, the changing is by way of your Spirit. And we see it in one another, we see it in ourselves, and Lord, we marvel because we know it's not something that we did by some kind of behavioral modification, but it's heart change, Lord, that you have done that changes us from the inside and is manifest in the outside. And so, Lord, we welcome that tonight. Pray that you would use our time in fellowship, use our time in the study of your word, Lord, in Romans, our time of praise, Lord, when we acknowledge together as brothers your goodness, and we acknowledge together as brothers in this room, brothers online as well, that you are good, that you are gracious, and you're faithful, and that we need you, Lord. We just recognize that common need together, and we'll do that in song and give you praise as well, Lord. So please use all of that tonight to continue the work you're doing, which we thank you for, in Jesus' name, amen. Brothers, there are two chapters in the Bible that you could just really camp out for a long time on. And one of them we've already gone through, Romans chapter 8, and the other one's Romans chapter 12. I think those two they're like gold mines, and you just keep digging. There's so much treasure. I don't even know if you have to dig that far, actually. It's right there. So we are tonight going to be in Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, and just the first two verses, because it's that rich, and our brother Marty is going to bring it to us. So let's welcome Marty.
Some fun, brothers.
So how have you been enjoying your travels down the Roman road? It's been rich. It's been a rich study, to say the least. In the first 11 chapters, Paul's been going over this gospel of grace. And now, since he's presented the gospel, Paul wants to say, brothers, this is how we live it out. You know the gospel. You know what I've said here. You have the head smarts of it. But it's nothing if we don't live it out, right? So how do we do that? How do we live out this gospel message? Well, that's what he's going to start explaining in chapter 12. So without any further ado, let's get right into it. Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. That's after chapter 11 from last week. Yeah. We'll get us there. And there we are. Verse 1. And I'll tell you what, two verses, guys. Why don't you read it with me, shall we? Sure. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Heavenly Father, living out the good news and knowing what your good, acceptable, and perfect will is sometimes seems like an impossible task. And yet, you have inspired the Apostle Paul to write that we can not just know it, but Father, we can prove it. So Father, be our teacher tonight. Be our guide tonight. Father, we seek to hear from you. And we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And here we go, brothers. Paul begins, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God. Now, beseech, it's not really a word that any of us use much anymore. In fact, we use it in the choir sometimes. We sing a song, we beseech thee, hear us. It's from Godspell. So we sing it there. You'll hear it a little bit in Shakespeare, beseech, and Romeo and Juliet and stuff. He uses it a bit. But as a whole, you don't say, I beseech thee, brother. What we do say, though, is the word urge. And the word urge is what the NIV and the ESV use. It also means to encourage, to implore. It means to sometimes exhort and to counsel. In this first verse, Paul is urging his brethren, his brothers in the Lord, to make a decision, to come to a conscious choice based upon what he has already written up to this point. And this choice is based on, look what it says in the text. It says, the mercies of God. He says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God. What were those mercies, you may ask? Well, I'm glad you asked that. The key is found back in verse 32. Of chapter 11. So if you're like me, turn back just a page. And to keep this mercy in its context, let's begin at verse 28. Paul writes, concerning the gospel, they, that is the chosen people of God, the Jews, he says that they are enemies for your sake, and that is for the Gentiles' sake. See, the Jewish community rejected the truth that the Messiah has come and that Jesus was that Messiah. But he says,
But concerning the election, that's being God's chosen people, they are beloved for the sake of the fathers. Paul wants here his readers to know that God has not abandoned the Jews, nor has he forgotten about the promises he's made to the Jewish nation. Rather, Paul writes that God's gifts and the calling of God for them is irrevocable. That means nobody can take that away. And here's the key to God's mercies, verse 30. For as you were once disobedient to God, yet have now obtained mercy through their disobedience, even so, these also, that is the Jews, have now been disobedient, and through the mercy shown you, they also may obtain mercy. That's a little bit confusing, isn't it? But all becomes clear in verse 32. For God has committed them all to disobedience. Remember, all have sinned and fall short of God's glory, that he might have mercy on all. Did you follow his frame of thought there? God did not cause the Jewish community to reject the gospel, but he used their disobedience to bring the gospel, God's mercies, and God's invitation of salvation to the entire world. Now, I have what I'll call a non-spoiler alert. This should come as, in other words, as no surprise. Our God is a sovereign God. And he's in full control of every situation. God's heart is always to seek and to save the lost. But the way he accomplishes his will here on earth, sometimes for us it can be very confusing, can't it? In fact, you might ask the question, why did God wait till I was 20 or in my 40s or 50s or even 60s to save me? Well, we can't always answer those questions, but we know that God is always working two ways, for our good and for his glory. Paul finishes up chapter 11 with the same thought. He says, "Oh, the depth of the riches, both of wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. For who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has become his counselor? Or who has first given to him, and it shall be repaid to him? For of him, and through him, and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen and amen." So back to our verse 1. In the light of all these mercies of God, extended to all mankind, according to his infinite wisdom, carrying out his perfect will on earth, Paul writes, he says, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God," but to do what? Look, it says, "that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service." So what does Paul want his brothers and us to do? That you present, that is, that you freely offer up to God, what? Your bodies. And this word in its context actually means your whole self, not just your physical being, but your whole self, your mind, your body, your spirit, all of your talents, all of your giftings. This includes how we spend our time and how we spend our resources, what we look at with our eyes, what we listen to with our ears, and what comes out of our mouth. Paul wants his brothers and us to present, to freely offer up to God our bodies, everything that we are, everything that we will be, offer up daily to God as what? A living sacrifice. Now, both the Jews and the Gentiles, they knew very well what sacrifices were. So when they heard that word sacrifice, they go, oh, but they were always used to dead sacrifices. Paul's asking them here to offer themselves up as a living sacrifices. First thing we know about sacrifices is that they're costly. Sacrifices had a financial cost. You either purchased an animal to have it slaughtered, or you took one from your flock. If you were poor, this sacrifice could just be one of flour or a pair of doves. Either way, there was a tangible financial cost to your family. This offering then was taken up to the temple or the pagan altar. Secondly, sacrifices had an emotional cost. Some of you brothers might remember when we studied Leviticus here. What was maybe 8 years ago? Yeah, 8 years ago or so we went through it. And we were taught that whenever a Jewish family was to offer up a sin offering in the temple, they would bring an unblemished lamb. And that young lamb was then bound by its feet and placed on the altar. And that family would then gather around the altar, place their hands on the lamb. And this would be a symbol for their sin being transferred to this unblemished or sinless lamb. Theologically speaking, this is called the substitutionary atonement. The high priest would then make an incision on the lamb's throat, and all the blood would be drained from the animal. The entire carcass would then be consumed in the fire. For the whole family to stand around and watch what the consequences of their sin had caused, taken out on an innocent, spotless lamb, the best in the flock. This was emotionally very hard on the family. And yet Scripture tells us that this offering made by fire was a sweet aroma to the Lord. Everyone around could smell that sweet sense of barbecue was going on. Paul states that we are to present our bodies, though, as a living sacrifice. We know what that dead sacrifice is. What's a living sacrifice? It's in the church, it's almost become a cliche that you hear this on this passage, and maybe you know it. It goes like this. The problem with a living sacrifice is that it can keep crawling off of the altar. That means running away. But I'll tell you, it's a lot harder for a living sacrifice to live on the altar of God than it is to run away. Before we knew Jesus, see, if you were like me, we used to use our bodies to feed those desires of the flesh. But now that we belong to God, our lives, our bodies, everything we are to be used for His glory and His purposes. You might remember our study in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. Paul writes that, "Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have made from God, and are you not your own? For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." Our body, the temple of the Holy Spirit, the temple is a place where sacrifices are held. Therefore, our physical bodies and everywhere we are to be holy, that is, set apart for God. Paul calls us to be living sacrifices to God, not bound sacrifices forced to remain on the altar. But in the light of all the mercies of God, God's salvation, God's goodness, God's kindness, God's forgiveness, God's love, Paul says, present your bodies a willing, living sacrifice, holy, that is set apart for him and his purposes, acceptable to God, that is pleasing in God's sight. Maybe not in the world's sight, but we're to be pleasing in God's sight. Be that sweet-smelling aroma of costly sacrifice, which Paul says is our reasonable service. Paul's saying it only makes logical sense to offer everything we are up to God, because God is the one that has, number one, created us in his image. God has given us life. God has provided for us in our families. God has loved us before the foundations of the world. God has also provided the only means by which we are saved. You might remember from our study in chapter 5 of Romans how God demonstrates his own love towards us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. God, through Jesus' sacrifice on the cross, has saved us from the wrath through him. Jesus, of course, he's the perfect example of this living sacrifice. Jesus died in full, willing obedience to his Father's will. Even when he was dying on the cross, you remember, he could have called on legions of angels to come and save him. But Jesus knew there was no other way to save mankind. Jesus could not save himself and save us. Jesus paid the price for our sin, and we could never pay that price on our own. Jesus became that perfect, sinless sacrifice, the spotless sacrificial lamb that fulfilled God's righteous requirements. Paul's saying, doesn't this just make sense, brothers, to surrender to God, to present yourselves once and for all, fully holding nothing back to God, to this God who loves you so much? Paul says, all that you are, all that you have, he says, surrender yourself to God. God has always our good and his glory at heart. Doesn't this just make sense? Paul says that this is our reasonable service. This is how we worship and honor God with our lives, to be his living sacrifice to the world. Verse 2. Hey, we made it to verse 2 tonight. That's okay. Only covering 2 tonight. God bless. Verse 2. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Now, how many of you have an iPhone? Any iPhone guys? Yeah? How many of you, now iPhones work on the iOS system, right? We all know that. How many of you have Samsung? Samsung, my wife has a Samsung. Those work off Android systems. Those are operating systems, and there's a tiny computer in each of those phones, and although they do many of the same functions, the two phones aren't always compatible, are they? Some apps work here, some apps only work on Android. Well, when we were born, we were all born with one same operating system. And we'll call that the Flesh 1.0 system. From day one, this system has had a problem. It has a severe virus. It's corrupt. You may ask, why? Hey, Adam's sin. Now, when we were babies, the flesh 1.0 system seemed to function pretty well. We get hungry, we say, Mom, 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 and we start crying, right? And hey, Mom comes over, knows we're hungry or wet. Hey, they feed us. Worked pretty well. Then the flesh 1.1 revision comes out. We're a little bit older. We get a red ball and we go, cool. I like playing with my red ball, playing with my red ball. Then I see this other kid over here. He's got a blue ball. Suddenly I want that blue ball. I take the blue ball. That blue ball becomes mine and I don't want to share. I don't want to give it back. I suddenly became selfish, self-centered. I don't want him to have it. Life is all about me, right? I should get what I want, what pleases me. Oh, then the flesh 1.5 revision is released. That's when our hormones kick in, right? You guys know those days. New urges start driving our decision-making processes. Morality, common sense, decency are sometimes just tossed out the door. That's where I was for many, many years. Caught up in addictions, trying to please my flesh. I knew nothing about God or his ways or his plans for my life. But then one day, when I was 17, I was introduced to Jesus. And Jesus met me there. He met me in my sin. Jesus planted a new operating system in my life. Let's call it the Spirit 1.0 operating system. And as I surrendered more and more of my life to him, God began to purge out that old flesh-driven operating system. Oh, some of it is still there, believe me. And Paul says in chapter 6 that we should reckon that old man, or reckon it dead. God has freed us from the penalty of sin through justification. God is making us free from the power of sin through sanctification. And one day, God will make us free from the very presence of sin in our lives when we are glorified. Paul says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." In other words, don't let that old, corrupt operating system run your life. You didn't have a choice before with that old flesh-driven operating system. But now you have a choice. Be conformed or be transformed. The choice is yours. The word conformed in Greek is schematzo. It's where we get the word schematic or blueprint from it. Paul's saying, you don't have to live by the world's schematics or by its blueprints. Do not be conformed to the world. Do not let the world define what success is in your life. Do not let the world tell you what love is or what happiness is, or what it looks like in your life or your family's. Don't let the world press you into its mold. Rather, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. God doesn't want to just conform us or make us look like we're holy on the outside. Rather, God wants to transform us from the inside out. The word is metamorpho in Greek. God implants this new operating system in our heart, and he gives us this new heart then to honor and glorify him. And how does God do this transformation, this metamorphosis like that of a butterfly? Look at the text. It says, by the renewing of your mind. Now, you know what it means to have a magazine subscription renewed, right? We renew our subscription because our old subscription has expired. We, as God's children, living in a worldly, flesh-driven operating system all around us, are constantly having our minds polluted. The world is trying to feed us its schematics, its value systems. So how are we to be renewing our minds? Well, you might remember from our study in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, Paul writes, but we all, with unveiled face, and here's the key, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Did you guys catch that? Whenever we are beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, we are being transformed by the Spirit of the Lord. In other words, whenever you are worshiping God, whenever you are glorifying Him in His creation, celebrating Him and His creation in the mountains, at a retreat house, out at the ocean praying on Saturdays. Whenever we are fellowshipping with our brothers and sisters, like here tonight, whenever you are praying or studying God's word, you are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, being made like Jesus, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. But Peter says in his first letter, chapter 1, that this work of God transforming you is going to take some work. He says, therefore, Peter writes, gird up your loins. In other words, get ready to work. Be sober and rest your hope fully on the grace that has been brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourself to the former lusts, as in your ignorance when you didn't know any better, when the flesh was in control. But as He who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. God never called us to be sinless. We can't do that this side of heaven. But God did call us to be holy. That is set apart for Him. You know, my wife Pam, she paints. She's quite an artist. She loves to work in many different forms. And one thing she likes to work with is clay. And I always ask her, I said, well, why can't you just take the clay, put it on the table, and start molding it? She goes, yeah, you can do it that way. Some people do it that way. But she likes to spin her clay, like makes pots and things. And she says, as it spins, you begin working out all the bubbles. You work out all the impurities that are in the clay. In those days, you'd work out twigs and you'd take out rocks, things that when you went to fire them, they could make that pot just explode. And the beauty of this is that each creation is uniquely different. This is the way that God seeks to transform us, with His gentle hand, forming us, taking out those impurities in our life, working from our heart, working from within. Paul writes, Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove, that you may live with full confidence, that you may live in joy and hope, that you are eternally linked and loved by God, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. God's will, it's always good. God's will is always acceptable, always perfect. God knows us better than we know ourselves. God knows what we need far better than we do. He knows what's healthy for us. So when we make this conscious choice to surrender to God in all areas of our life, our choice demonstrates our sacrificial love that we have for him. Let's read it one more time together, brothers, okay? Verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Heavenly Father, we cannot transform ourselves. Daily we feel the pressures of this world seeking to conform us to its image. But Father, we were made in your image. And Father, we have full confidence that you have a much greater work to do in us. And that work is to transform us into the image of your Son, Jesus. So Father, help us. Show us how to gird up our loins and get to work pressing back against the world. In the same way, Father, show us how to surrender more fully to your will every day. Be with us this week, Father. Lead us and guide us in your way. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Amen.
Set free my heart. Set free my soul. I don't wanna be a prisoner no more. Unlock the door that holds me in. This is the day that life begins.